All right, good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. All right, good to have you. Good to see you out this morning, and welcome to Southside for our Father's Day service. Today is not only Father's Day, but it's also in the Georgia Baptist Convention, Baptist Men's Day. So it's the reason you see the men's in a different type capacity than what you normally see this morning, but it's because of the Baptist Men's Day along with Father's Day. No better way to start it than opening prayer. We've asked Brother Ty Rollison to lead that for us, please.
Let us all pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, it's so good that we could be here this morning. Father, we just thank you for every opportunity we have to get together with a body of believers. We thank you, O Lord, for the blessings that you bestow upon us, each one of us. And Father, as we accept this day, we thank you, Father, for the fathers that are here today, Lord. And we just ask you, dear Heavenly Father, for your leadership and your guidance in our life as we try our best to teach one another about you. Father, we pray, O Lord, for the ones who could not be here this morning, for the ones, dear Heavenly Father, that are sick for different reasons or away with family or friends. We pray, Heavenly Father, for this hour, that they might feel a very touch from you, O Lord, and that they might know, Lord, that they are your children. There is nothing more important, Lord, in life than you. Lord, we just praise you and we worship you. And we ask you, O Lord, to lead our life in every aspect, Lord. You be first, Lord, in everything that we do. Now, dear Lord, we pray and thank you so much for this church. We pray, Heavenly Father, for the leaders of the church, Lord. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that we will continue to love and praise you. We're so thankful that Jesus Christ is the head of this church. He means so much to us, dear Heavenly Father. Now, Father, just be with us during this service. Help us all along the way. And, dear Father, keep us in your love and care. And, oh, Lord, forgive us for we have failed you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Ty. And now, Mr. Tim Sawyer, we're... That's right. I'm sorry. The video. We have a Father's Day video. We have a couple of those. And we'll play one at this time.
Today is a special day. And it's bigger than we think. Because there are many different kinds of fathers. And they all need to be recognized and honored today. Today, we honor those fathers who consistently strive to balance loving their wives and children with being good, godly workers at their jobs. May you feel the pleasure of God. Today, we honor those dads who had poor fathers themselves, but who have committed never to become the father they grew up under. May your children continue to be guarded from any of the hurt you carry. Today, we honor the fathers who are older and who no longer have day-to-day obligations to their own children. May the family gatherings this weekend make you feel like you could do it all over again. Today, we honor the adult children of fathers who were absent. May the God of the fatherless become your father in ways you've only dreamed of. And may you believe with your whole heart that his leaving wasn't your fault. Today, we honor men who have no children of their own, but who father younger men as mentors and guides. May you see your important roles as impacting and life-changing. And finally, today, we honor fathers who have passed away. May their good deeds live on through you, and may their careless deeds be corrected in your lifetime. Today is a special day. So for all the fathers we mentioned, and even those we didn't, be honored, be blessed, and be joyful. we believe that you have what it takes to change the world, and you're doing it one relationship at a time. Happy Father's Day.
Good morning. And those of you who don't know me, I'm Tim Sawyer, and I am otherwise known this morning as the B string that got thrown into the game this morning. I'm excited to be here and to lead you in music. We'll start with a fellowship hymn and a fellowship time. If you will, please stand. It's hymn 653, God Give Us Christian Homes. Those of you who know it, sing out strong, because I understand it's been a while maybe since we've sung this here at this church. But I'm guaranteed that some of you should know it. So let's sing along.
God give us Christian.
We'll go ahead and put those verses up there. I'm Richard Gill, and I'm just honored to be here this morning. Brother Heimer Thomas asked me, it's been about 3 months ago that he asked me if I could participate in today's services, in Father's Day services. It was about 3 months ago in the hardware store, and then about a month and a half ago, I think I told him, yes, we will, and I told him what I do. And this morning will be nothing what I told you a month and a half ago, and I'm being totally serious. What struck me back in March, and then over the next month and a half, was a couple of songs that, I mean, it was on my heart to do a couple of a cappella songs, one that we have never done as a family. One of them, the children were going to sing, and it's one that Carol Ann and two of her sisters have sang together before a cappella, and it's called As For Me and My House, We Will Serve the Lord, which I found out this week is not the same one that Brother Tim knows. There's another one that's almost the same word, but anyway, it's totally different. It didn't happen. And the Lord works mysterious ways, and there's just things you just cannot understand, you can't fathom, you can't predict, you can't, it is what it is. So you're getting this morning what I did not think of 3 months ago. I mean, and that's where we are. I do want to point out this morning that we all in this room this morning, every one of us in this room had a daddy. Every one of us. But not every one of us had a father. And even those that had fathers, they varied in their qualities, their attributes. And guys, what I'm about to tell you is this. Men, whether you're an actual daddy or whether you're not, we are to provide that Christian leadership in our homes. And for decades, we have fallen behind the women in our communities. If it were not for women holding down the pews or propping open those church doors, there would be a lot of churches that would have already fallen. There would be a lot of churches that would not have even come into existence. We have failed there, guys. Now, I'm including myself there. It's time for us as men. Here, let's make it on Father's Day, let's do this. Let's start providing that Christian leadership that we are supposed to have for our own families, starting with our own families, and then into our church, and then into our communities. And then that'll spread nationwide. It'll spread internationally. But it's all got to start with us. We got to find it in ourselves there. God set us up to do that, and we have fallen short, and we need to get back on track. When the Israelites were finally getting back into that promised land, Canaan, they had to cross a river that was in the flood stages, and there's the story about the 12 stones. I know there's a fellow ag teacher of mine that's retired now. He's my mentor, my hero in the ag education world, Dennis Shepherd. He has a dairy farm up in North Georgia, and they call it 12 Stones Farms, and it deals with each tribe putting a stone down during the flood stages. But you understand the crossing of that flood, there was a marked division. There was a division from where they were to where they were trying to get to, which was the promised land. You understand that this thing was, so when you read this verse and he talks about the river, and in the King James Version, it actually uses the word flood. Well, flood, river, whatever. I mean, the flood they're talking about is the flood stages of that river. What about those gods that were on the other side? When the Hebrew children were in Egypt, when they were wandering around in the desert, for 40 years, they tried to stay away. I mean, God was pointing the way the whole time. There was a little cloud by day, and stars. They were being guided. They saw God at every hand and still wasn't following. And then when it got to Canaan, they almost didn't want to go into Canaan. Oh, there's giants in that land. And then when they did get in Canaan, they thought, well, to fit in, and we do this today, and to fit in, let's just serve the gods that they're serving. I mean, for 40 years, their families have been, everything had been handed to them from God. The manna, everything had been handed to them. He'd been leading and guiding and directing, and they still wouldn't do it. You know what I mean? We got to do that, guys. We got to follow God. And Joshua says here in verse 14 of Joshua 24, verse 14, it says, "Now, therefore, fear the Lord, serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of that river and in Egypt. Serve the Lord. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites," as the people that were there, "and in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Do what you want to. You can get on board, guys, this morning here, and you can start providing that Christian leadership, or you cannot. Whatever you want to do, it's up to you. And I sure wish we, you know, I wanted my children to sing that song that Carol Ann and her sisters used to sing. It didn't happen. Then there was another one called I Have a Father Who Can't. We've sang it beautifully in the car before, just over and over, but Friday night we were trying it in the car again, and it didn't work. And I don't know if y'all know this or not, but a cappella songs, unless they're perfect, you just don't do them. You just don't. So we're never going to sing either one. What's going to happen this morning is this is a song that Carter Lynn wrote about 2 weeks ago. And y'all know that my children have a gospel group of their own. And it's a gospel group that I did not set up. They did. They chose to do this. They wanted to serve the Lord through their song, through the talents that God has given them. And in light of all the tragic things that have happened that have just wrecked this community, you know, I mean, you know, we got three big ones on the prayer list, plus there's just been multitudes added to it since then, you know, but with the Sarah Kilgore and the Brett Cruz and the J.C. Thomas, and then, you know, and then you had Kayla McLeod's family that had to be prayed for. You know, I didn't know if our community could take much more, but there's a purpose in everything. Well, in the light of all this, Carter Lynn wrote a song, and it just quickly just fell into place. I mean, this isn't like you heard it on the radio and had to learn the words to it. She had to write, she wrote it, and I don't know if it's ever been pinned down, actually. But the other kids joined right in and got it, and they've arranged it, and they're going to present it to you this morning. Now, this is in light of all the tragedies that's going on. They call themselves R828. And I'm proud to call them my family. I'm proud to be their father. And so I hope you can, and some of you may have seen this on Facebook, may or may not have. Anyway, this is going to be the first live version of that song, other than being in my living room, you know what I mean? And I enjoy hearing it. So anyway, they're going to present it to you, and that's all I'll have for today.
Like he said, this was kind of in light of all the tragedies. I know I have two of the people I'm very close to. I was very close friends with Kayla McLeod, and I'm very close friends with J.C. Thomas, and I know of the other ones, I mean, relation. But when all that stuff went down, it really, just like y'all, I was hit very hard with it. And I prayed about it. I prayed every night, and I just came to realize that it's not like God didn't know it was coming. He put it on us for a reason, and he has a purpose for it. And that's what this song is about. It's about finding peace and knowing that God's in control. And it kind of just develops that throughout the song about how we are lost and we think, where's God right now? What's happening? But nothing can touch us that doesn't pass through his hands. And that's kind of the inspiration. And I want to ask if y'all would please stand and worship with us. It's raining, it's pouring, I can't see any eagle soaring, no. All I see is heartbreak, oh God. Where are you now? Where are you now? God, we need you, we need you to be you. We want you, want you to move in our lives. Take the tears from our eyes, your grace will suffice. Bring us back to life. It's Goliath, we're crying. Where is the stone? Oh God, we are trying. We can't do it alone. We're not alone. I will never know what your plan is, what your plan is, but I know my heart is willing. We need you to be you. We want you to move, move in our lives. Take the tears from our eyes, your grace will suffice. God the Lord will speak, he will speak peace to his people, to his saints. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, he will speak peace to his people, to his saints. We still need you to be you. We know you, know you and move. Move in our lives. He is alive. He is alive. Jesus gives us life. It's Goliath. We're crying. We can't do it alone. But we're not.
Beautiful. Thank you, Richard. What a great way the Lord to take care of things. He'll work it out. Our plans have changed in the last couple of weeks in a lot of ways. And just let the Lord speak to us, and we sure things are, what a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful song. And thank you for allowing the Lord to lead you in that at this special time of need, or special time. On a broader scale, or maybe the opposite, on a narrower scale, we're here today to celebrate Father's Day. Now, that song was about a father. It was about, she's asking for help, asking for guidance, asking that God takes care of all of us. That's sort of the role of our earth, of all of our fathers in the world today. As Richard said, we have set back and let other things kind of take the role of the daddy. And exactly why we've done that, don't know. Some people say it's because women are louder than men, so we just shut up and let them talk. I don't think that's necessarily the truth. The women just go after something, and they do. And this is kind of... I want to talk a minute about the history of Father's Day. Father's Day was established, and if you look on Facebook or do some other looking about Father's Day, you will find that there are several different people that claim to have started Father's Day. We know that Father's Day was started because of Women's Day, or Mother's Day. Mother's Day was established back in around 1908, 1906, something along that timeline. Young lady was sitting in that service as they were honoring mothers. This young lady was one of seven children that was raised by her daddy. Her mother died at childbirth when she was born. And as she was sitting there, she said, I have no mother to celebrate, but we ought to have one of these days that we can honor our fathers. So in 1910, she, in Spokane, Washington, decided to, in their church, or in their area church, to have a Father's Day. And they did, in honor of the fathers in honor of the people that raised them, whoever that it might have been, you know. She was 27 years old then. Let me catch up to where I was. I was going to have to read it, but I don't. This honor, again, Father's Day, was basically established to mirror Mother's Day, to have it just like it. But she established it to take place in June because this is the month her daddy, of his birthday. So it was established in June. Of course, that was in 1910. It really didn't gain national attention until 1924 under the former president, Calvin Coolidge. It gained traction during World War II, and in 1966, President Lyndon Johnson proclaimed the third Sunday in June to be Father's Day. President Richard Nixon in 1972 made it a federal holiday. Now, enough about history. Census shows that there are more than 70.1 million dads in the United States. 2 million of these dads are single dads. One of the things, you mentioned the history, I'm going to back up just a second. One of the things that kept Father's Day going, it was established as a time to honor fathers. But it was also found it's a good spending day time. Companies, businesses, big stores said, we can't let that go. Right now, it's the third leading money maker in the United States. Fourth. Three ahead of it. Christmas, Easter, and guess the other one? Valentine's Day. Women spend more on men for Father's Day than men spend on women for Mother's Day, if you want to know that too. This year, spending on Father's Day will reach about $12.7 billion. That makes my $3 or $4 look a little flimsy, doesn't it? All right. Anybody remember Jim Valvano, where's my basketball people? What's his name, Dean? Valvano, okay. He had a statement or a quote that says, my father gave me the greatest gift anyone could give another person. He believed in me. Well, we could all kind of get with that, couldn't we? Father's Day. How many fathers? At the opening of the service, we had a video that told about the different types of fathers. We know a father, basically, along with the mother, help make the children. But there's, as Richard said, there's a lot more to it than that. What about fathers? If you fit one of those categories on that tape, would you stand? Nobody fit the category. All right, categories. Fathers that are involved in their children's life. Second one, men, stay standing, because we're going to have some joining. Their father, that your father is dead. Your father has died. Would you stand? Okay. A few more. Want to honor them. All right, let's see what the third one was. Not there was one more, but if there's other fathers that are not standing, you have children, would you stand please at this time? All right, now, good. Be seated, please. How many are fathers for the first time? This is the first year you've had the opportunity to claim or call yourself a father on Father's Day. Stand, please. All right, one here, one back there. All right. That's quite an honor. Thank you much. It seemed like there was one more, but don't really matter. At this time I want all the men that were just standing, you stay seated. Everybody else, ladies, other young people, would you stand? Would you turn to that one sitting down around you and thank them for their service as dads, as fathers, role models? They fit that category. All right, be seated, please. Thank you. Let's give them a hand. I asked several, we have a little gift. It's small, but it's really good. It's a little pen. Am I wrong?
One more category.
Okay. All right, children, if I ask you to come help me give these out, come do so. Come up here now, please. All of our men, stand, please, if you're a father. If you stood a while ago, stand again. Some of y'all go and share them. There you go. Fathers, when you get this pen, you can be seated. So, I want to close with this, a little rhyme about Father's Day. And it hit me pretty much as my children was coming along and grandchildren, and especially now with Luke, and he got in trouble because he wanted to come up here with his G-daddy, and his mama wouldn't allow him. But when I read this, it kind of hit me, and I'm sure it will hit some of you, not as bad. If you're young, you're right. If you're older, try to keep up with grandyoungins, grandchildren. This is for you. My dad is tall. My dad is strong. He's as smart as he can be. So why does it seem that he works so hard just to keep up with little me? Thank you. Happy Father's Day. Bless you. I hope everyone have a great, great day. Brother Tim.
Okay, so it is almost time for our offering. We'll have an offertory song. I'll be playing during the offering while it's taken. And Brother Richard just, wow, it's like deja vu all over again, because what's in my head was exactly what he said about fathers needing to step up to the plate and needing to lead their families. We lead in so many other ways. We try so hard to be in charge, which, like Heinrich said, you know, why do we even try? Because we know the women are all really in charge. But we do need to provide leadership, and especially in the family, when it comes to spirituality and leading our family to Christ, leading our family in all spiritual things. Therefore, I asked Brother Frank, during the song that I'm going to play, it's a classic Chris Tomlin song called We Fall Down. And I want you to think of this, especially men. We try to be in charge, but the second line of this is we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. We're not going to try to be in charge there. We're going to give over that responsibility to God, because Jesus is the one that can lead us to lead our family. So anyway, I'll just end with that. How many of you know a song called the Family Prayer Song? Anybody familiar with that? It actually is the verse, Joshua 24:15. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Let's all stand. I'm going to sing it for you one time, and then we're going to all sing it together. Let's stand as we sing our fellowship, not a fellowship, our offertory song, Family Prayer Song.
As for me and my house.
Let's pray.
Father God, we come to you just thanking you for being the best father that any of us could have, God. Father, you lead and guide us each day, God. We just want to lean on you and let us be the men that we need to be to lead this, our children, to accept you as their Savior, Father, and also be the man that you want us to be in our personal lives and our walks with you, God. Father, just give us the boldness to stand up, to face whatever we may come up against us, God. Father, we praise you in the storm, and we thank you for this opportunity to be in your house to hear your message. Father, right now we just ask you to bless these tithes and offerings. Give us the wisdom and the knowledge to use them to glorify your kingdom and everything that we do through this church and this community, God. We just lift your name on high, in your name. Amen.
Stay right there for just a second. Would you lead us in singing that song?
We can do that.
Is that okay? Would y'all like to sing that song? We heard him play. I was like, I want to sing it too. That was a great job. Thank you so much. Go ahead,
sure,
Brother Tim.
Let's just do that. If you'll just play that track again.
At the feet of Jesus. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Gosh, thank you everyone who has shared so far. It has blessed me so much. I've enjoyed it so much. Haven't y'all? Hasn't been a wonderful service so far? If you have your Bibles, turn to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, we're going to be reading verses 1 through 4. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Now, I got to be honest with you while you're turning to Ephesians 6. A couple of weeks ago, I was talking to Brother Heinrich, and I said, Brother Heinrich, who's preaching on Father's Day? And he goes, well, you are. And I said, I have a little technical problem. I'm not a father. What am I going to say? He goes, well, you're the pastor. You need to preach on Father's Day. I said, no, why don't we get one of our fathers to preach? And so he said, no, you need to go ahead and do it. I said, all right. But fathers, I got to tell you, I feel solidarity with you a little bit. I just want to share with you, I think for 4 hours, one time in my life, I understood what it was like to be a father. A couple had an emergency. I was about 30 years old. They dropped off their little boy with me for 4 hours. No, it gets better. I knew nothing about kids, and his name was Jeremy. And I said, Jeremy, what do you want to eat for supper? You know, your parents had to leave you with me. He says, Cocoa Puffs. So I gave that boy 4 bowls of cocoa. When those people came back 4 hours later, I had lost my mind. That sugar hit that boy's bloodstream, and he went insane for 4 hours. So, dads, I feel your pain a little bit. I know what you go through. No, of course, fathers, we are so happy to honor you this morning. You know, thank God, I don't have to tell you what a father is supposed to be. We have God's word, amen? God knows what he's talking about. One of my favorite passages, a couple of chapters in the Bible, is Ephesians chapter 5 and Ephesians chapter 6. It talks about families and relationships and all that. And we're going to look at that and hear what God has to say about what a father should be. And by the way, even if you're not a father like me, this message is good for us, men. This is stuff we need to hear from the Lord. Doesn't matter if we have kids or not. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1, here's what it says. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with promise, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. Kids, let me just say, you know what that means? If you listen to your mother and father, you will probably live a lot longer than if you don't. That's a good advice. If you want to live a long, healthy life, listen to what mom and daddy are trying to tell you to do because they're looking out for your best interests. Okay, then verse 4, we're going to feature that this morning. It says, and you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. What a great passage. Let's pray together. Father, we love you today. You are our heavenly fathers. Brother Justin just prayed a few moments ago, Lord, and we owe you so much. Thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy toward us. And Lord, every man in here, we all want to be what you want us to be, Father. No matter if we're a father, if we have children and grandchildren or not, Lord, help the men in this church this morning to hear what you have to say to all of us. Father, we love you. Thank you for the privilege of leading the families that you've given us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, now I haven't got used to wearing this thing. Is this thing on? Can you hear me? There's the blessing of this new sound system. I cannot hear myself. That is a gift from God to me. Every day. Somebody's clapping. Thank you so much. Okay. All right. Let me give you 3 characteristics of a godly father or a godly man or a godly mother or a godly woman. This will work for anybody. I'm going to give you 3 characteristics from this passage of Scripture. Specifically, verse 4 is what we're going to be looking at this morning. 3 characteristics. He says in verse 4, he says, and you fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. Let me give you number 1. A godly father is always nurturing his child's mind, body, and soul. Think about that. A godly father or godly mother or godly uncle, grandfather, it can be anything, is always nurturing his child's mind, body, and soul. You know, I want to show you a picture. We're going to go down memory lane in just a second. And this is going to be interesting. Okay, let me just ask you, raise your hand if you know what this is. Oh, yeah, some of us know well, don't we? The rest of you who don't know, let me take you down a trip back into the Brantley County history of Brantley County, Georgia, because a lot of us who are a little bit older are well acquainted with this machine.
This is what you sit on, and the tractor pulls you. The tractor is in front of that drum there. This is how you plant tobacco into the row to have a tobacco plant to later come back and pick 100 times. Right, guys and girls? And string and all that kind of stuff. This is called a transplanter. The people sit on there. Inside those little metal boxes are the tobacco plants. Can y'all see down at the bottom? You see the big green drum? That's got water in it. Then underneath, do you see that plow thing on the very bottom? Everybody see that? They pull that behind the tractor. That digs a hole, and you stick the tobacco on the wheel that's in the middle, the little tobacco plants. It grabs them. It takes them around. It puts them in the ground where they need to be in the right hole, and it waters them at the same time. And you go down the row and you plant it, and every plant is exactly where it's supposed to be. I couldn't work one if my life depended on it today, but I used to be able to. It does what it needs to do. Dad, men, this is us. God wants us to take care of children with that kind of care and dedication from the moment they're born till the moment they die, if they die before you do. God wants every man in this room, including me, when we deal with children, to nurture everything we possibly can. That machine right there took such good care of that little tobacco plant. It got it in the ground. It got it watered. It got it ready to grow. That's your job, Dad. That's our job as men. We are to take the leadership role in the family, in the church, in the home, in the school, wherever you are to be a leader helping raise people to love and follow Jesus Christ. There's your job description. That's what every man who calls himself a Christian has been given that job. You know what children need to see more than anything else? You do this for a child, you have won God's lottery, if you will. If you do this, men, and if I do this, if children see that daddy would rather die than betray Jesus Christ in any way, can you imagine what that does to the life of that child? What kind of fertilizer that's putting into that child's soul that they're going to grow up and remember, my daddy, my granddaddy, my uncle, my pastor, my Sunday school teacher, the man that I saw loved Jesus, they would rather be dead than betray Jesus Christ. Don't we need that in this world? We need men like that who will stand up and say, Lord, I got it for you. I got my family. I got my church. They're not going to have to hunt me up on Sunday morning at the church. Where am I? Because I'm going to be there, Lord. I'm going to be there because if for nothing else, I need it and the people coming behind me need it bad. You know, what a difference it'll make. You know, it doesn't matter really if you teach your child or grandchild how to hunt and fish. I love all those things, don't you? I mean, I wanted to go fishing with daddy and with my uncles when I was a kid. That stuff is wonderful. I love that. Every boy, every girl, every child should spend time with daddy and granddad. But if you teach them everything, teach them your trade, give them the family business, and they die and go to hell because they never accepted Jesus, what good have you done, your offspring? Zero. You've given them something a little bit, but they're going to have to stand before God just like all of us are and say, God's going to go, why should I let you into heaven? And the only answer is going to be because the blood of Jesus Christ has forgiven me and covered my sins. You know, there's this guy named Tim Hansel. He tells this story. This is such a great story. This is one of those father and children time together. Fathers and daughters, fathers and sons. He said he took his son out. And they were out climbing around on some cliffs, just having a good time, a boy and his daddy. And all of a sudden, Tim said his son was up here kind of behind him, and he heard his son, Zachary, say, hey, Dad. And when he turned around, the kid had already jumped from the cliff up above. They were in the mountains, you know. He said, all I could do is just catch him, and we both fell down. And, you know, he said, I got up, and I said, are you crazy? You know, we're on the side of a mountain here. What are you doing? And his son goes, Daddy, I knew, you're my daddy. I knew you would catch me. What do you do for your children, Dad, or men, if your kids know that Jesus has caught you? What does it do for them? Wow. Incredible. Children today need to see Daddy reading his Bible, daddy praying, daddy making everybody get up and go to church on Sunday morning. Amen? Not mama. And children need to see daddy talking about Jesus Christ in public. Wow. If daddy is too big to take time for Jesus, what do you think the kids are going to do when they get grown? Sorry, I can't come to church. You know, I got my career going on. That old Cats in the Cradle song, everybody knows that song, you know? The little boy, by the time he grew up, just like his daddy. How important is daddy? Wow, to every child. Charles Francis Adams was a 19th century political figure. He kept a diary. We still have his diary. One day he wrote this in his diary. Listen to this, y'all. He said, I went fishing with my son today, a day that was completely wasted. But his son was being like daddy, and his son kept a diary too. They have the diary from daddy from that day, and they have the diary from the son. His son's name was Brooke Adams, and he made this entry in his diary. I went fishing with daddy today. It was the most wonderful day of my life. Wow. A godly father is always nurturing his child's mind, body, and especially his child's soul. Point number two. I love this too. This makes me guilty for many years of my life. Point number two, a godly father is never satisfied with being a basic Christian. What do I talk about? What do I mean a basic Christian? I walked the aisle, I got saved, I got baptized. That was it. That's a basic Christian. That's what I'm talking about. We've all been there, haven't we? Everybody in this room, including me, has been a basic Christian. The day you got saved, the day you got baptized, you were a basic Christian. Guess what, though? God doesn't want men to stay there. That's where we start from after we're saved. We're supposed to grow forward. Let me ask y'all a couple questions here. At Southside Baptist, if I wanted to find out how to raise blueberries, what man in the church am I supposed to talk to? I hear a bunch of names. I heard David Lake, all right? There's other people, too. If I was that came to Southside Baptist Church and I wanted to know how to build a house, what man should I talk to? Let me say one you don't want to talk to is me. You know, there's a bunch of men who know carpentry. I'm looking at one of them right now who knows house building. If I wanted to come and talk to a man at church and learn how to use a computer, who would I talk to? Brother Heinrich, right? If I wanted to learn how to start and run my own business, what man in the church should I talk to? Now, let's take it home. If I see on the news where a Baptist church in California got on the news, the preacher was preaching his sermon and they had it on the news, a Baptist church in California where he said, we ought to kill, line up every gay person and shoot them. Who needs to know how to deal with that? It just happened this week, y'all. The two churches that have caused the most news have been Baptist churches. That made me just weep because I was so ashamed. Because that's not us at all. Who do you talk to? Daddy. You're supposed to know that. You should know the Bible enough to know, hey, wait a minute, that is wrong. That is not of God. That is wrong. We love everybody and we want everybody to get a chance to be saved, right? Anybody that comes in this church and wants to learn about Jesus Christ is welcome. But after you're saved, that's a whole new ballgame. Now we expect all of us to live holy lives. Amen? That's a lot different than getting up in church, calling yourself a Baptist and say, all the gay people need to be shot. That is not of God. He would never say something like that. So who's supposed to know that? Daddy, when your kid comes home and says, hey, you know, Daddy, I'm dating a girl who's an Anglican. And you're like, a Whatican? You're supposed to know this stuff. Or Daddy, our new preacher says he's all about Calvinistic Reformed theology at our church. What in the world is that? And Daddy goes, I never heard anything like that in my life. Brothers, let me tell you, it is our job in the church. We are supposed to be the biblical experts of the church. We are not supposed to let the ladies know more about the God's word. Amen? In our families, we're supposed to be the one who knows God's word backward and forward and can tell the truth from a lie. Why? Because our kids need to know what we know. If you know nothing, they're going to know even less.
about your faith. A godly father is never satisfied with being a basic Christian. Let me tell you why this is so important. The Christian Businessmen's Committee did a survey, some kind of survey, research. This was in a magazine called Discipleship Journal. And they said, listen to this, y'all, statistic here. When the father is an active Christian believer, there's about a 75% likelihood that the children will be active Christian believers. But if only the mother is an active Christian believer, it drops to 15%. 60% if daddy loves Jesus and stands up for Jesus more, that your children are going to follow God. A godly father is never satisfied with being a basic Christian, not just for himself, but for his family. All right, number three. This is hard. Before I do this third point, raise your hand if you were, all that your parents had to do was just say something to you and you would behave. We got a few. There's some people not telling the truth that raise their hand. I get that. Okay. Raise your hand if it took every belt in the house, I'm raising mine, go ahead, to get your attention. Okay, in other words, you were going to talk back no matter how many beatings you got, and you deserved every one of them. Okay, I need to hold both hands up. That was me as a child. Okay, point number three, this is so true. A godly father finds the right balance between discipline and love at home. By the way, every child is different. Every child in your family is going to need a different way of dealing with him. The same love, but different discipline. Daddy, you can't be too hard. God doesn't want us to be too hard on them, but he doesn't want us to be too easy on them either. Amen? Either one can hamstring your children for life. I know adults right now that would stand up in this church. They live here in this area. Would stand up in the church and say, I don't care if my daddy had the cure for cancer and I had cancer, I am not going to see him on Father's Day. Why? Daddy was so hard. When they were kids, they had no mercy. They couldn't do anything. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Daddy was so mean, he was trying probably to get them to listen and mind, but he overdid it and he drove them away. And now as adults, they have a fractured relationship with daddy. But I also know adults who would say, I wish my daddy had just beat me one time with the belt. Just once, maybe I wouldn't be in the mess I'm in. Y'all know people like that too? That say, daddy, my daddy didn't have that problem, by the way. He knew how to use the belt well. I wish daddy had disciplined me. Because daddy tried to be my buddy instead of my father, that has messed me up as an adult. I went wild and daddy didn't do anything about it. He tried to be my friend. Children today need to know daddy loves me, but daddy's also going to set some boundaries for me. By the way, isn't that how God is? God loves me, but God also has boundaries. If I get out of God's boundaries, what's God going to do to the child of God? He's going to tear me up, right? He's going to tear you up. It's a spiritual belt he uses, but he's going to spank us and discipline us because he loves us as a father. Let me tell you, there was this pastor. This kind of convicts me. There's only been one time I can really know that I dealt with a child in this church bad, and I have regretted it ever since. I was way too hard on them. I don't forget what they were doing. I think, a couple boys were fighting in here. You know, and I jumped in there and tried to solve the problem, and one little boy never came back to the church after that. And I am ashamed of that. This pastor was a pastor at Newcastle-on-Tyne in England, a city over in England. He began a series of children's meetings. I love this story. At the very first meeting, anybody that's worked with kids know this is going to happen. Four boys came in with whistles and blew their whistles the whole time he was trying to preach. Right? What do you do? An usher came and got those boys out of the Bible study. And later on, the pastor came to see him. This was genius. The pastor said to him, he said, can't you guys play your whistles any better than that? If you can't play better than that, I'm going to have to get my wife to give you some lessons. 4 weeks later, those four little boys who were causing trouble in the pastor's message played their whistles for everybody during the children's meeting. They took what the kids did and worked with them and loved them right into the kingdom of God. It takes that balance, doesn't it, dads? It takes a balance of discipline and love. I want to tell you, fathers, my hat is off to you this morning. I don't know how you do what you do. I don't think I could have done it or could do it. But imagine the payoff. Now think about this, dads. This is when it's going to get worth it. Imagine getting to be here or wherever when each one of your children accepts Jesus as their personal Savior and gets baptized. Because you brought them up that way, imagine that. Imagine getting to be in heaven with all of your kids and grandkids. They all got saved because of the legacy that you left, Daddy. Imagine laying down at night knowing all of my kids are responsible, godly adults with families of their own. They're not perfect, but God is teaching them and they are listening. That's some pretty good sleep right there, Dad. And imagine Jesus saying to you, "Well done, good and faithful father. Come on in to the rewards I have." Let me leave you with one last illustration here. This is such a good illustration. There was a young fellow, he was sentenced to the penitentiary. The judge knew his father. His father had passed away. His father was a well-known lawyer in the town. And right before the judge was going to send this young man to go away to the penitentiary, he said to this young man, he said, "Son, do you ever think about your father any?" And the boy who was about to go to jail, he said, "Yeah, I remember when I went to my father for advice, and he looked at me up from his book he was writing and said, 'Run along, boy, I'm busy.'" He said, "And yeah, no, I went from my father for companionship. He turned me away, son, and said, 'Run along, son, I got to finish my book that I'm writing.'" Your Honor, this is what the boy said, "You remember him as a great lawyer. I remember him as caring more about his stupid book than he did me." Whoa. Wow. Moral of the story, men, you can have an incredible professional resume. You can have lots of money. You can have all the fame in this world. We can have great reputations in the community, and we can do all of that and lose our children along the way if we're not careful. Let's pray together, and then we're going to have a hymn of invitation. Father, we love you. Thank you for the fathers, the men in this room. Lord, I thank you that we can hear from your word, your holy book, the Bible, that tells us what we're supposed to do. Father, I thank you for every man that's here. I honor them, Lord. And I just pray you bless them in every way. Father, all of us are a work in progress. Help us to do your will, want to do your will more than anything else in our lives. Father, I pray that in the next year in this church, we will see men stand up as never before to take places of leadership, to lead the families of this church. Father, I thank you for my brothers. I thank you for my sisters, and I pray you bless them. Lord, as we have an invitation, help us all to hear your word and let it sink into our hearts and change what we're doing now if it's not pleasing to you. We love you, Lord, and it's a privilege and honor to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand and have a hymn of invitation. Brother Tim's going to lead us. The altar is open. Whatever you need to do, this will be a great day to be saved. Men, women, boys, or girls. Amen. We'll take you on Father's Day. Come on, as we sing. Blood can cleanse each spot. God, okay, there we go. Brothers and sisters, the Lord is moving in this church, and we don't need to leave until we allow Him to do whatever He wants to do in each of our lives. Please come. There's time. You got time. It's Father's Day. You're not going to be able to get in any restaurant anyway for a long time. Come on. If the Lord is dealing with you, please come as we sing. We're going to continue to sing. Amen. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming today. I hope you had as much of a blessing as I did. Can we thank the men who led this service, who took it? Brother Heinrich and everybody. Thank you, Brother Richard, Brother Tim, your family. Thank you so much. Dads, we love you. We honor you. By the way, if anybody wants an extra pen, you don't have to be a dad. They're going to go back to my office, so please come over here and get you a pen before you leave and take home with you. Are there any announcements? We are not having service tonight so that you can be with your family on Father's Day. Any other announcements? Brother Justin, anything? Youth will be leaving at 5:30 to go to the gathering place. If you've never been, it is awesome. Youth? Baby bottles. Yes, thank you, honey. Anybody that took a baby bottle home to fill it up with change, they're ready for us for CareNet to give them back to CareNet now. So go ahead and bring that baby bottle back and fill it up with plenty of change for those little babies. Any other announcements? Yes, sir, Brother Walt. Yeah, I'm going to ask Brother Wyatt to close us in prayer, what he was just telling me. Did everybody hear about the shootings in, we have a video to close the prayer, yes. Did everybody hear about the shootings in Waycross last night? 3 or 4 people were shot, and I know a couple are dead, so let's pray for it. It was in Garlington Heights, neighborhood of Waycross, so let's be praying for them. We have Brother Heinrich, you want to close the service? Come on. And I'll go to the back right here. You want this thing?
Dear God, thank you for giving me the greatest daddy in the whole world. He goes to work and makes money so we can buy food and toys and have a nice house. He's really tired when he gets home, but some days he takes me to the playground and pushes me on the swing. Sometimes he even plays dollies and tea party with me. That's just how much he loves me. I like when he comes to my school programs. He always tells me that I'm a great singer and he's proud of me. He teaches me all kinds of stuff too. And other times I learn just by watching him. at bedtime, he reads the bestest bedtime stories I've ever heard. And then he prays for me. God, my daddy loves you so much. That's what I learned to love you so much, God, by watching my daddy. So, God, if you wouldn't mind, can you please make this the best Father's Day ever for my daddy? I'll cut a picture of him that he can put on the refrigerator. You know, he says I make the best art in the whole world.